Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living from our teacher and pastor, John S. Torell. Our hope is that you'll be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. This morning, Pastor John continues a series entitled, I Am the Lord, I Change Not. Have you ever noticed that a lot of people, even Christians, are in the habit of using the name of God as a curse word when they get angry or something goes wrong? Why is it that the name of Jesus is used in such a manner? The names God, Jesus, and Holy Spirit are revered and honored in the spirit world, but when they are used as profanity by mankind, Satan gets the satisfaction of grieving God, and the individual is cursed. The Sabbath day is not really taken seriously anymore, so how do you think God views it when mankind does not observe a day of rest? These are commandments 3 and 4, and there are 6 more which direct us to honor our parents, not become a murderer, stay away from adultery, not be a thief, always tell the truth, and not covet someone else's possessions. These directives are part of the moral law, and Jesus said that they will be enforced until heaven and earth pass away. This message is entitled, The Ten Commandments Continued. Now, let's join Pastor John as he begins today's message.
Praise the Lord, and welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church, worldwide on December 20th, 2015. And I'm going to continue today on my teaching on the Ten Commandments, and we're going to see how far we're going to get today. Hopefully, I will get through. And I want to begin reading a scripture from Isaiah chapter 55. That is a book of Isaiah, chapter 55, and beginning with verse number 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, is the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, returns not thither, but waters the earth, makes it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes forth out of my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Now God said this, that his word shall prosper. The Ten Commandments, I would say, would be likened to God's Constitution. In the United States, we have a Constitution, and then we have a number of laws under the Constitution, but they have to line up with the Constitution. And the word Constitution in Swedish is grundlag. So God has in grundlag that he has made before he even started to create the universe and everything else. What I'm doing here with the Ten Commandments is to give you an overview. After God gave the Ten Commandments, he spoke to Moses and he gave additional laws that expounded upon these this Constitution. And you have it in the book of Leviticus, you have it in Numbers, and you have it in Deuteronomy. These are the laws that God has that comes under the Ten Commandments. As we progress in the Old Testament, you will find that God spoke and gave some more laws through the prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Ezekiel. But the great lawgiver that gave these laws in the Old Testament is Jesus Christ. And when he came to earth, spent 3.5 years, he simply fine-tuned. He didn't destroy these laws, but he went beyond these laws. He went on a deeper spiritual level. So we have in the New Testament additional laws that are in harmony with the Ten Commandments. So let's look upon these Ten Commandments, and they are unchangeable. The Constitution of the United States can be changed. It takes Congress, the Senate, it takes to go to the different states and make amendments. It's a long process. But God's Constitution, the Ten Commandments, cannot be changed. You see, the American Constitution is a man-made doctrine. It's probably one of the finest constitutions, and it was birthed under the auspices of the Holy Spirit. But you see, it still is made by man. And it can be, they simply said, you can amend it. And it has been amended a number of times. They added on amendments. But this Constitution stands. And I want to turn right now to the book of Exodus. That's the book of Exodus. And we're going to take a look in chapter 20. That's Exodus chapter 20. And we're going to pick it up in verse number 7. And this is commandment number 3. And I read, "You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that takes his name in vain." What does that mean, to take the name of the Lord in vain? If you go to a court in the United States and you walk in there, there will be a judge, there will be bailiffs that are keeping order in the courtroom. Now, that judge demands a certain language when you address him. You cannot say to the judge, "Hey, dude, what's up, man?" You don't address a judge like that. If you do, you'd be held in contempt of court. You call him your honor. You say, "Yes, sir. No, sir." You had to be very exactly the language in a courtroom in America. And you cannot talk anytime. You talk when you're asked to talk. If you try to talk when you're not supposed to talk, they shut you down. If you're obnoxious, they will arrest you, handcuff you, and take you away, and you do some time in jail. You don't mess with a judge. Now, if you meet the president of the United States, and I'm not saying just this president, but as far as the office is concerned, if you have an official meeting with him, you address him as Mr. President. You have to use the title. It's official. Now, let's talk about God. He's a creator. He's the owner of everything. He's Almighty God. And Satan hates him. He can get at him, but he can get at him through people. Isn't it amazing that one of the most powerful swear words that men have on earth, particularly here in America, is when they say, "Jesus Christ." And they use that as a curse word. They're degrading the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I used to do this when I worked in the secular world. And I heard that, I would turn around and I would look at the person and say, "I didn't know you were a Christian calling upon the Lord." And they would stop and get flustered and thought, you know, I've attacked them. When we use the name of the Lord in vain, it invokes a curse upon us. Now, the Jews are at times schizophrenic. particularly the Kabbalistic Talmudic Jews. So they want to keep this commandment. So what they did was this. They said, well, the real name of God, one of the real names of God is Yahweh. And they said, we will not pronounce that. If I don't speak the name, in case I'm sinful, I'm not right in the right position with God, I don't want to speak it in vain. So they will use the word Adonai. And Adonai means Lord. So they said, if I don't use his real name, but I use Adonai, then I don't take his name in vain. This is what Jesus told the Pharisees and the others, that they were splitting hairs, that they were simply doing their tradition. Now we say, God, damn it. We have a number of different things. Now, if you're working on something, and I hear this all the time, and I try to correct people. Let's say you're working on the car, you're working a piece of equipment or a computer. Something was wrong, and you says, God damn it. Now, why do you want to curse your equipment? Why do you want to curse your car? Why do you want God to bring down a curse upon what you're working on? That's insanity. You want to say, God bless this clunker. God bless this stupid computer that's not working right now, whatever. But you want to bless it. But you see, it's ingrained in us. From the time we are born, we hear our parents talk. We hear people in school talk. We hear people in the shops talk. And we pick it up. Now, as Christians, we don't usually swear like others do. We are more sophisticated, and we have what I call Christian swearing. And I'm sure you heard people say, you know, oh, golly, that stands for God. Oh, my gosh, that's just another word for God. Gee whiz, that stands for Jesus Christ. So you want, because Jesus said in the New Testament that every word we speak, we should give an account of. Words create. Words blesses, and words destroy. So God simply said this, I am holy. Honor me. Do not use my name as a cuss word. Do not use it lightly, but use it in reverence. Let me talk to you fathers. When your children were younger, even when they get older, teenagers, there's one thing that irritated you more than anything else: disrespect. Now, if your son came up, let's say 12 years old or 15 years old, and said, hey, you old man, you don't know what you're talking about. Why don't you shut up and go back where you came from? I'll take care of this. You will not take that very lightly. Those are fighting words. You would say to his son, you and I got a problem. You are the problem. We're going to settle this right now. You're going to show me respect. Let me talk to your mothers right now. If you have your children talking back to you, you're not going to be very happy. And you're simply going to say, you know, you don't talk to me like that. I'm your mother. Show respect. Well, here's our Heavenly Father. And we show him a lot of disrespect. So this is one of the commandments. Number three, do not take the name of the Lord in vain. Let's go to the next one now. And this is called meddling. Commandment number four, the Sabbath. Let's start in verse number 8 here. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Now the Greek word, not the Greek, but the Hebrew word for Sabbath does not mean Saturday. Sabbath means day of rest. You see, there's a lot of people that are ignorant, particularly some preachers, and they really haven't studied much, and they read this here and say, oh, Sabbath, that must mean Saturday. It doesn't mean Saturday, it means day of rest. So here's what God said. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. What does the word holy mean? Holy means separate. You're separating yourself. Set it aside. Holy. God is holy. He set aside. He's light. There's no darkness in him. He does not do well with people that are in sin. We are holy, set apart, washed in the blood, saved, born again, holy. 6 days shall you labor and do all your work. This fits any calendar. Because you see, over the years, calendars has come and gone. Matter of fact, a few hundred years ago, I don't know how many hundred years ago, between the Julian calendar and the Gregorian calendar, it was so off that they made an adjustment of over 300 days. And so the Hebrews, Abraham, when he started in life, he was on a Chaldean calendar. When they went to Egypt, his offspring, they became on a Egyptian calendar. When they came into the promised land, they were on a different calendar. And then we got the Babylonian calendar, the Assyrian calendar. And so it's been a mishmash of calendars over the years. And no one knows what day the original Sabbath was. We don't know that. God said he worked for 6 days, created everything in 6 days, and on the seventh, he took a day off. That was a Sabbath, day of rest. Now, that fits every calendar. If you're a Chinese, you're some other place, or, you know, Middle East, or whatever it is, because everybody got their own calendar. It is very simple. God knew that men will have a hard time to keep time. And by the way we have it now, a day is not perfect. So because of that, the calendar we are here in the United States and in Western Europe, we have a leap year. And that means that we have a February 29th. So if a man or if a boy or girl is born on the 29th, they have a birthday every 4 years. Why do you have a leap year, a leap day? Because it is not exact. So we have to simply put them on in and fix it up, and that'll be good for another 4 years. Then we got to fix it again. So God simply saw this name. It doesn't matter where you live, what calendar you're on, you work 6 days, and the seventh you take off. Now, if you live in Israel, you're going to be blessed, because there, you see, the Muslims, they have Friday off. Friday is a Muslim Sabbath. They don't work. They close their shops. The Jews close their shops on Saturday. They don't work. The Christians close their shops on Sundays. They give you 3 Sabbaths a week if you live in Israel. So, which day is the Sabbath then? Well, it depends upon where you live, because God didn't say that you had to be specific. So what we do is this. We live in the United States. The custom here with a majority of the people, 90%, is Sunday is a day that we have off, and that's been a Sabbath day, so that's what most of us do. Then we have the 7 days Adventist and others. They have Saturday off. Nothing wrong with that. God bless them. That's their Sabbath. And then the others says, well, every week is a Sabbath. But you've got to have 1 day off. All right, enough on that. But a seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, your manservant, nor your maidservant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger that is within your gates. Notice now, on the other commandments, they are basically one-liners. God is really spending some time here. He's saying this. Now, I'm serious about the Sabbath day. He said, now, you're not going to do any work. Neither are your daughter, your son, your servants, maidservants. You're not going to work your cattle. You're not going to, anything that is in your household should come to a stop. Regular work, stop. Does that mean you cannot cook a meal? No. Does that mean you cannot make your bed? No. Does that mean you cannot wash your dishes? No. But it means this. You don't have to clean your carpets on Sundays. You don't have to paint your walls on Sundays, wash your car. You don't have to go shopping on Sundays. There's a number of things that you do not have to do to give you time to read the Word, to worship the Lord, to pray, and to rest. God wants us to rest. Jesus said the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. That's a day of rest. This is a day if someone is sick, you can visit them. Somebody needs to be called, you can call them. But you don't do your regular work. Then God said this. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that in them is, rested the seventh day. The Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Now, having a Sabbath day is a blessing. If you go back to the time outside Israel and you go to the Babylonian Empire, the Assyrian, the Egyptians, they worked 7 days a week. Slaves got up, sun up, went to stop working at sundown, 12-hour work, 14-hour works, 7 days a week, no time off. And God said man needs a day of rest. It's a blessing to have a Sabbath. It's a blessing to be able to take a day off and simply say, today I don't have to do my regular work. Today I can pray, worship the Lord, take time, and just rest. That is a blessing. So this is something we really want to keep. Let's go to the next one right now. Commandment number 5. Honor your parents. That's verse number 12. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon a land which the Lord your God gives you. Here's a spiritual law built in. Why does God want children to honor their parents? The family unit. It's a building block of every nation. If a nation has strong families, you have a strong family, a strong nation. If you have weak families, like we have today, single parents, unwed parents, and you have children, orphanage, and so on, it's chaos. So God simply said this. It's up to the parents now to teach the child to honor your parents. Why? Because if you learn to honor your parents, you will get along fine in society. But if you are a rebellious child and simply hell-bent, you're going to have problems when you get into society. You're going to have problems holding a job, relationships, and in your marriage, and with your children. God wants law and order. He has a hierarchy. The man is the head of the household. The woman is a mother. She is working under him. This doesn't mean he's a dictator, but you can only have one boss. The children are to be under the parents until they are adults. And then they are released, and then now they start their own families. How do you honor your parents? It doesn't mean that you have to agree with everything your dad or mom do or say. Because some of your other parents today are in sin. But it means this. You honor them. You simply say, well, you might not be the best parent and you might be in sin, but you are my dad, you are my mom, and I'm going to honor you for giving me life. I'm going to respect you. I am not going to talk down to you. I'm going to show you respect. And if you want to, I will help you out as we become adults, our parents get older. And the way God set it up was they had no nursing homes in Israel. The family, when the children grew up, the parents got sick, older. It was a duty of the children to take care of the parents until they died. And that's when you had a welfare system where no one was a ward of the state. Everyone simply said, that's natural. We take care of mom and dad. And the children knew that when their time come, their children would take care of them. That's the way God set it up. So, what about if your mom and dad passed away? Well, there's nothing you can do. If you haven't honored them, you ask God for forgiveness. And that's all you can do. I repent of it. But if your parents are alive, use it right now. Use that time to show them respect. Give them some love. Remember this. Many other parents have arrested development spirits. They simply children, had children. They are hurt. They got soul damages. And they need help. So if you as a child got right with God and you have the Holy Spirit, then simply say this, but praise the Lord. I cannot minister to my mom and dad. That's what I did. I came from a dysfunctional home. A lot of fighting in the home and so on. I got saved. My wife and I came to Christ. And I became a peacemaker. And I was able, we led our parents to Christ. We were able to minister to them and to help them out. And I'm glad we did. I'm glad we put the time in to take them out sometime for a dinner, to help them in their homes, to do some repair work and so on. Our parents are gone now. And when I was a teenager, I was horrible. I cursed my parents. I wrote bad letters to them. I did all kinds of things. But praise God, I was forgiven, and I had a time to make up. And when mom and dad passed away, wife's parents passed away, we had peace. We knew where they were going, and we had a good relationship, which we are going to resume when we get over on the other side. So honor your parents, and you will live long in the land. That's a law that God said. If you honor your parents, you will live long in the land. That's a promise. Let's go to the next one. Verse number 13. Do not kill. You shall not kill. You shall not murder. It's a one-liner. What does that mean? It simply means this. I don't have the right to take your life. You do not have the right to take my life. Your life is precious. My life is precious. And if we got disagreement, and this would happen, people kill one another, anger, jealousy, resentment, first murder by Cain. He simply got jealous of his brother, so he killed him. This is built into society. You cannot, as an individual, kill anyone. Later on, Jesus also expounded on it and said, you're not going to hurt people, damage them. Gossiping, that's killing their reputation. Do not physical damage. God simply says this. I gave you life. I gave other people life. They are not yours to take. You cannot kill. Period. What about the death penalty? Well, the death penalty is not meted out by an individual. It's meted out by the state, the government. God simply said in the Bible, there were certain crimes that God said, this is a death penalty on it. And it was, they had to have two or three witnesses. It had to be proven in court. And it could not be a vigilante. It could not be by an individual. Now, God had simply said this, if a man murders or kills another man, a woman, he has forfeited his own life. He is to die. When we don't punish murderers with a death penalty, we are simply destroying our society because that takes away a barrier. And people take it lightly. Oh, I might get 10 years, 15 years, whatever, you know. It doesn't matter. So the Bible says there's a death penalty by the state on a murderer. It still stands today. God had a death punishment for homosexuals. We're no longer a theocracy. So that thing, as far as we are not under the same law as Israel was. But killing, murdering is a universal law. The next one, number 7, verse 14. You should not commit adultery. Why did God say that? If you go to the animal kingdom, cows, bulls, you know, little bit here, little bit there, no big deal. Dogs, you know, they don't really have a spouse, you know, they just do it here and there and yonder. Most birds, you know, they are not faithful and so on. But why did God say, do not commit adultery? Because adultery destroys the family. When you commit adultery, you have spiritually killed your marriage, destroyed that, because you took a vow, and you destroyed that. That's why today, 50 to 60% of people in America are divorced, and people divorce, like, you know, they're going down to have breakfast at a restaurant. There's no problems. What does it do to the children? I tell you what. It's pretty bad for a child to stay the week with mom, weekend with dad. What does that do to a child? It destroys the child. He loves the mom. He loves the dad. He has a split life, split personality. There's a soul damage. Children up in an orphanage. There's a soul damage. And God simply said this. You shall not commit adultery, period. Don't even think about it. This also deals with fornication that is brought up in the New Testament. Because, you see, if you fornicate or you have sexual relations before you're married, you have simply married that person, this person, because when two people come together, they become one flesh. And I would say that most Americans have ungodly soul ties where your soul is knitted to maybe 30, 40 different people. And if you're a man and you're knitted to all these women, remember these. The women that you had sex with have been unfaithful. They've fornicated with other people, which means that you are knitted to a network of souls, which brings in demons to the max. And God simply said in my constitution, you shall not commit adultery. Non-negotiable. The next one is number 8. Commandment number 8, verse 15. You shall not steal. One-liner. Why is that so important? After all, picking up a few things here and there, why is it so important? Because you see, theft destroys integrity. God builds societies. He built the nations. We are to work together in civilizations, in societies. And God simply said this, you shall not steal. Because if you have theft, it destroys commerce. Think about this. We are paying about 25% more for items you buy in a store because of people shoplifting. Somebody could pay for the shoplifters. So what the merchants do is this. They notice that there are going to be people stealing. They steal all the time. So the price goes up. So when you go in and you buy something, you are also paying for those that stole in that store. If you have too many thieves, the system breaks down. And God simply, you should not steal. That means if you have a job, you don't take pens with you home. You don't simply make phone calls, private phone calls on your job, because you're contracted to work 8 hours a day, whatever you are contracted. And if you make personal phone calls, you are stealing time, and time is money. We are not to steal anything. We are to be honest, have integrity, and simply they can trust us. There are repair shops, automotive repair shops, that I encountered over the years. They would cut wires. They would do damage to a car. They take the car in. You can't go into the shop. This is off limit. They're monkeying around in there. Come back and says, well, you know, it's not only this, but you got this problem or that problem. That's theft. Common in America. Dishonesty. God said, you shall not steal. Commandment number 9, do not lie. You should not bear false witness against your neighbor. You should not lie against your neighbor. Bear false witness. Lying destroys all integrity. I want you to know that. If you have what they call white lies, or a little bit lie here and there, you have invited demons into your life. And who can trust you? If you lie over here, what hinders you from lying over there? Most people lie out of fear. You confront it. Did you do this? Did you know about this? No! You did. You lied. Fear. There's nothing more destructive in a society. You take the President of the United States, he's a professional liar. You take his political handlers, the people working in the White House, they are professional liars. You take senators, congressmen, judges, Supreme Court judges, I tell you this, Unless someone is really a Christian, most of the leaders we have are professional liars. They will not tell you the truth. You take people that are newscasters. You take weathermen, people that are reporting the weather. You get a lot of chemtrails, completely fill the sky, and you turn on the weather report. Do you ever hear one of these reporters say, well, today it was a bad day. We got a lot of chemtrails today, a lot of spraying, so be careful. You ever hear that? No. If a reporter would say that on television, he's fired immediately. There are certain things you can't talk about, so you have to lie. Remember Lyndon Johnson? Some of you older. He gave press reports about the war in Vietnam. By the way, he was a Democratic president. And he said, you know, we're doing a lot of damage and it's doing pretty good. We were losing 1,000 men a day in Vietnam. They brought them home in body bags. And finally, it came out we were losing that war. I remember Lyndon Johnson speaking on television saying this, but he was going to ramp it up. He said, we're going to flood the jungles in Vietnam with American troops, and we're going to annihilate the communists. Well, he flooded the jungles, and they died in the jungles. Lying. Coming back, I can't spend too much time on that. Here's what you want to do. I used to be a professional liar. I mean, I lied for nothing, for everything. And God convicted me when I got saved, came back to Christ. He showed me this. Lying is something you do not do. Consequence, it doesn't matter. But you tell the truth. And this is what you want to do. You want to be a truth teller. And it used to be, when I was a church pastor, someone came up, a lady came up and said, what do you think about my new dress? Well, I said, you know, it's not my style. You don't like my dress? Look, lady, we got different, you know, things we think about. You know, we got different styles. So I'm not going to lie and say, oh, that's a beautiful dress, to tell my wife later, that's a horrible-looking outfit that woman had. So when you have people ask you things, don't give compliments unless they are true. Be truthful. All right. Commandment number 10. Do not covet. You should not covet your neighbor's house. You should not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his manservant, nor his maidservant, nor his ox, nor his ass, nor anything that is your neighbor's. God said this now. In order to have my society working perfect, don't covet. If you go into somebody's home and you see they got 5 cars in the garage, don't say, oh, why can't I have that? Simply say, well, God bless you, brother. I'm glad you got all that stuff. Be happy for the people. But don't covet. That's a sin. And God said, I don't want that. Be content with what you have. He said, don't covet somebody else's wife. You might, before you were saved or whatever, you married someone, both are getting a bit old, a little bit on the older side, and you meet someone else and they have a beautiful wife, and you go, wow, I like that. You're coveting. That's not no property. Don't go there. Be content with what you got. And simply say, thank you, Lord, for what I have. I don't need what other people have. I'm going to be happy. And I'm going to give this one example I gave years ago, but it happened right in church. We had a good friend of ours. He was a song leader. He's gone with the Lord right now. His name was Wid Coriel, good friend of ours. And he was a manager for one of the insurance companies here in Sacramento. He was making a good salary. And he went and bought a Volvo, brand new Volvo. And, you know, that was a luxury car, you know, but you know, not a Ferrari or something like that. And when he was a boy, he had bought an old Volvo, a new Volvo at that time. And he always dreamed, when I get more money, I'm going to buy myself another Volvo. So he did. Parked it right outside the church, right outside the entrance door. And he came in beaming, you know. He was so happy. Some people saw that, and they say to him, shame on you. Why do you drive a car like that? We don't have that. You shouldn't have that. And they destroyed his joy. And he parked next time way off where no one would see him. Coveting. So if somebody buys a nice car, they get a nice home, or they get a nice motorcycle, whatever it is, simply look at it and say, but God bless you, brother. God bless you, sister. I'm so glad that God has given you a little blessing in your life. Don't covet. And if you don't covet, God will begin to give us what we need. He will give us what we need, not what we greed for. All right. Let's wrap this message up. We got the Ten Commandments here. So let's turn to Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17. That's Matthew 5, 17. Jesus said, think not that I'm come to destroy the law. And when you read, talk about the law here, talk about the five books of Moses. The Torah. It's called a Torah. And they simply translate in English to the law. Think that I'm come to destroy the Torah, the five books of Moses, the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I said to you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot, one tittle shall in no wise pass for the law, till all be fulfilled. Now, God said this. My law, the Ten Commandments, Constitution, and all the other laws that I made. We're not talking about sacrificial laws now, but talk about moral law and the practical law. Will stand through the reign of the Antichrist, through the thousand-year kingdom. It will stand through the great white throne judgment. And these laws will not pass until the believers in Christ have been removed to the new creation. Unbelievers have been put in the lake of fire. And God is dissolving this entire universe. Then these laws will no longer stand. Why? Because those of us in heaven, we are sinless. We don't need it. We are perfect like God's holy angels. And those in the lake of fire, they have been punished. They are paying for it for eternity. And it doesn't matter if they sin anymore in the lake of fire. It's just going to be the same punishment forever and ever. That's what Jesus said. If Jesus said that, don't you think that you and I should simply say, well, if Jesus said it, I believe it, that settles it. That's the done deal. We don't mess with it. Now, you don't get saved by keeping the Ten Commandments or the laws of God. We keep the law because we are saved, not to be saved. I'm going to close here today in Deuteronomy chapter 28. Deuteronomy chapter 28. And this is God's planet. Now, if I come to your house and you invite me for dinner, and I come into your house, I'm your guest. Right? Now, if I says, well, you know, I don't like the way he got the living room here, you know, so I'm just going to rearrange it, and I don't like that chair, so I'm just going to throw that out, and I'm just going to rearrange his house. The people in the house that invited me are going to say, look, buddy, you're a guest. You either behave or go. Get out of here. You mean I can't mess up your house? No. That's our house. You can mess up your house, but don't mess our house up. Okay, we understand that. But now, this is God's house, this planet. He said, don't mess up my house. And the devil says, oh, you can do this and that. The consequences. Let's read a few verses here. That's in Deuteronomy chapter 28. And it shall come to pass, if you shall hearken diligently. Hearken means listen. Diligently means real careful. Unto the voice of the Lord your God. Where's the voice of the Lord? In the Word, in the Bible. To observe and to do all his commandments. He didn't say not some. He said all his commandments, which I command you this day, that the Lord God, the Lord your God will set you on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come on you and overtake you if you shall hearken to the voice of the Lord your God. And then he goes on and say how blessed you're going to be. Let's just be practical right now. You and I are guests on this earth. We agreed upon in all the sermons. Everything that you have belongs to God. You're the manager. You don't own any cars. You don't own anything. It's God's. You're a guest. Matter of fact, you don't even own your body. That's loaned to you. You, your spirit and your soul, you are a guest living in this temple. We own nothing. Now the Father is saying this. When you are in my house, you may use all my things that I have freely. Be blessed. But you got to do it under my rules. I got laws. And you got to obey these laws. If you obey them, you're going to be blessed. Now, if I go and visit Brother Soteris and his wife, Joanne, and they're going to have a dinner for me, they're going to bless me. I'm going to walk in. They're going to be blessed with food. They're going to serve me. They're going to be nice to me and so on. But if I get into the house before we sit down and eat, and I say, hey, you know, oh, I don't like your couch. And I toss it out, you know. What you're doing over here? I don't like the way you've got things set up. You know, I begin to rearrange his house. I'm not going to have any dinner. I'm going to be told to leave. And I'm going to say, well, can I eat? I mean, I like to have the food. He said, no, you violated our rules. You tore this place up. Get out of here. That's what God is saying. You obey my rules. I bless you socks off. But you disobey and rebel, and I will curse you. There's going to be a punishment. If you notice now, that blessings are, how many blessings do we have? We simply have 13 verses of blessings. But you read this chapter, and you will find you have 68 verses, which means about close to 40 verses, where God says, I will curse you here, I will curse you there, I will curse you here, I will curse you there, I will destroy you. He had more verses on curses than on blessings. Now, our charismatic friends and some other people are into the faith movement, you know, they read the first 15 verses and they stop right there. And they say, I claim this, I claim that. Well, you can claim it if you're walking the Lord, First of all, you've got to be saved. But here's what God said as we come to a close here. He says, now, in verse 14, and you shall not go aside from any other words which I command you to this day, to the right hand, to the left, to after other gods, to serve them. But it shall come to pass, if you will not hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God, to observe to do all his commandments and his statutes, which I command you this day, that all these curses shall come upon you and overtake you. Now, in verses 1 and 2, he talked about blessings overtake you. He says, now, if you break my commandments, then all these curses shall come and overtake you. Now, if you break one of God's commandments, does that mean that you lost your salvation? No. But it means this, you're in a doghouse. And that's not a nice place to be. It means that God is going to withhold the blessings. And you see, Satan reads the Bible. And Satan holds God to his word. And the devil and his demons, if they see you break a commandment, they will simply immediately lodge a protest in the court in heaven and say, Brother Jones just ran a red light. He did it on purpose. I demand, according to Deuteronomy chapter 28, that we have the legal right to afflict him. You see, the demons cannot touch you unless you first break some of God's commandments. And that's why they want us to sin to get access to us. Every week when we have prayer meeting, we pray for safety for every man, woman, boy and girl affiliated with our ministry. And yesterday my wife and I had a great miracle. We were on the freeway, had done some food shopping, coming down, doing about 60 miles an hour. And it was 65 miles zone, so I was okay. And we're going to take an off-ramp. And I got in the lane in correct time. And then I realized that the car stopped. It was jammed. So I started my brakes, and I was able to stop. I didn't have any problems. And I looked in the rear window, and I saw three cars dancing behind me. They were coming down fast. This happened, bloop, bloop, like this. One car simply shot out on the side of the road, got off the road. Another car followed. Another car braked behind me. And they barely stopped. They were just dancing around me. I could see, looking in the rear mirror, I could see the lady sitting in it like this. Now, I told Lina, we just had a miracle. There were angels back there that simply pushed those cars out of the way. They were not hurt. There was a lot of smoke of tires that were burning. I mean, there was blue smoke coming up all over the place. But no one was hurt. God will protect us. We pray for that. And I thank God for that yesterday. So here's what I want to close with to pull this together. You have a choice. I wrote this here. You have a choice to obey and be blessed. You have a choice to disobey and be cursed. God said this, you are a guest in my house. Here are the house rules. You have an opportunity. If you obey the house rules, I will bless you. If you disobey the house rules, I will curse you, and you will have a bad time. Now, what do you want? Do you want to be blessed, or do you want to be cursed? Why is it that we are prone to sin? It's rebellion, the sinful nature in us. or we don't realize the price we're going to pay. In most churches, they don't preach responsibility. They don't preach about absolutes. So people think, well, you know, God will understand, you know, I do this and that, you know, and I'm lonely, I just need some sex for now a little bit, you know, God will understand that, you know, I'm just lonely. Or, you know, I need this, I'm just going to take some money from these people over here, whatever it is. God will understand. And God says, I don't understand. I'm not sentimental. You got house rules. Obey or disobey. Choice is yours. Simple. You're out in a restaurant. You see that big ham. You see some nice pork chops. Your mouth is watering. You see a lobster, whatever it is. And your mouth says, I want that. And you simply take it, and you know the Bible says, you know, we're not to eat that. Leviticus chapter 11. Some of you don't know that, so you're thinking everything goes. But if you have the knowledge, you know that. And you go, oh, to hell with that. I'm going to do it anyway. I'm not going to obey. I don't like that. You got a choice. Obey or disobey. You might say, well, that's a small thing. God said, all things obey. And listen, if you, in your life, if you want to deal with other people, and they say, oh, that's just a small thing. No. In our relationship, everything should be good, not just some things. The choice is yours. And the question now is, what are you going to do about it? Now, we had an object lesson here. I took one little slurp out of this water. And you notice when I started today's sermon, I was coughing pretty bad. I mean, I was really coughing. I didn't cough before I got in here. I haven't coughed all night. I haven't coughed all. And so I was coughing. So, just a demon attack. So what do? You rebuke it, cast the demons out, and in faith believe, they're gone. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. The same thing. I know this. If I obey God, then he's going to bless me. I don't have to worry about it. He's going to chase me down. But I do know this, if I disobey him, he's going to chase me down and say, here, son, here is your curse. Eat it. I don't want to have that. I want to eat this blessing. Don't you? Have you ever been stopped by a highway patrol guy or someone, police officer? You violated something. You rolled down the window. Guy came up and said, you violated this and that. He got his pad up and he started writing. You know how you feel? Oh, praise God, I'm going to get a ticket. No, you don't feel good. You know, give that ticket. It's going to cost you. You're going to have to go and pay a fine or whatever it is. That's how God does. He has holy angels watching over us. And they write you up. Give you a ticket, say, here's your curse. Eat it, and you repent and turn around. The choice is yours, blessing or curse. If you're not saved and you listen to me right now, you says, but, you know, I really like what you said, and I want to get on board. I want to be blessed. What do? Well, here's what you do. You simply ask God to forgive you. Simply say, God, I'm so sorry for my sins. I messed up. Lord, I repent. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe he rose from the dead, was crucified. I repent right now. Jesus, come on in and be my Lord and Savior. Save me, Jesus. And he will. When we finish here in prayer, after Thomas has prayed, Brother Charles is going to come. You're not going to see, but you're going to hear him. He's going to lead you in a great salvation prayer. And he's also going to tell you exactly, verse for verse, how to get saved. You listen to him, get your salvation today, and get with it. And to the rest of you, this season, every day of the year, obey and be blessed. God bless you. Here's Thomas.
Father God, thank you for the word today, Lord, and thank you for our many blessings, Lord. We thank you that we have a guideline for living on the earth. We recognize that God the Father is a loving God, and He is the ultimate Father persona. And I thank you for that, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you three questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything, even something insignificant like a paperclip at work? 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all three questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these three questions are but three of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5, 7-8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us, in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are three places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of two places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." You see, God offers his love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says, "Today is the day of salvation." Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country,
and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Torell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast of Pastor John S. Torell. This message was the sixth part in the series, I Am the Lord, I Change Not, and was entitled The Ten Commandments Continued. The Apostle Paul said that the moral law is a schoolmaster that brings us to Christ, because it is like a mirror that reveals our shortcomings. The law offers a better hope and draws us closer to the Lord, but it has nothing to do with salvation since the born-again experience comes by faith, and not in keeping the law. The Ten Commandments offer mankind a choice to obey the Lord and be blessed, or disobey and receive a curse. The problem is that many people question the validity of these commandments today. Think about that for a moment. The entire Christian faith would be a farce if the Ten Commandments and God's moral law were nullified. When Jesus walked on the earth, He clearly established that the moral law would be in effect until heaven and earth passed away and we enter the new creation. These commandments have withstood the test of time. They are unchangeable. Mankind has the choice to be blessed or cursed. Blessings come from obedience, and rebellion leads to curses, and the outcome of your decision will be with you for the rest of your life. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1527. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address once again is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.